So as you're settling in, we've got a warm-up for you.
Welcome to Unity of Walnut Creek. My name is Carl. I'm so glad to have everybody here this morning celebrating our time together and kicking off our new 10-part series on the One, in a way. Please join me in welcoming our featured musicians today. We have seven of them, Lisa, Diane, and Annie, who were just up here. accompanied by Tyler, Dusty, Larry, and Mary. Thanks, all of you. I invite you to turn your cell phones to silence as we enjoy this sacred time together. And please join me now in waving to the camera and saying hello to our friends at home. Your presence is really added to our spiritual community, and we're so glad you're with us today. Unity is a positive path for spiritual living. Our vision for the world is we envision a spiritually awakened world where all life thrives in conscious oneness. Our mission is who we have come here to be. So let's say it together. We are a loving, inclusive community, expanding and living our divinity in sacred service for all. And our core values are love, connection, service, and wisdom. I invite you to join me in affirming our statement of faith. Together, there is only one presence and one power in the universe and in my life, the all-loving goodness of God. And now I invite the ushers to come forward. If you're with us for the first time today, let me be the first to welcome you. And we hope you choose to stay and meet some of us on the patio after the service. If you're comfortable, I invite you to raise your hand so an usher may bring you a welcome packet. John, I think I've seen you before. And if you didn't raise your hand and are new, you can get a whoop. There is somebody. Good. Inside your packet, you will find a connection card, and you may take it to the bookstore and receive a welcome gift. Once again, welcome to Unity of Walnut Creek, and we hope to see you again soon. Connection cards are available for everyone in the seat pockets in front of you. With this card, you may submit a prayer request, and our prayer team will pray with you throughout the week. You may also share feedback or request information, so please place your card in the basket along with the offering. And now let's take some time to greet the neighbors immediately around you. Thank you. thank you guys, and I want to thank Dave for guitar. Yeah. Tyler and Lisa, you have too many people in the music program. I can't keep up with them.
Sorry about that. No, I'm not.
No, don't be. So we have several things to highlight this week. Would you like to help clarifying what your soul's intention for you is at this stage in your life? Well, you won't want to miss our Soul's Intention workshop today at 2 o'clock. The workshop will include Qigong movement, group hypnotherapy, and mixed media art collage to help you express your discoveries. Kaleo and Elise will be on the patio to answer any questions you may have after the service. Join Lena St. Michael on Wednesday, January 29th for a workshop on heart-centered activism. In this workshop, you will have the opportunity to transform outrage to courage and compassion and see a way to be politically active with enthusiasm and without hating and harming anyone and discover, isn't that a good idea? And discover the joy in conscious, heart-centered, civic or political engagement. And backed by popular demand, we are having a self-care day for women. Yes, yes. On Saturday, February 1st, so not too far away, we will have mini classes and pampering services to nurture and stretch women's minds and bodies. The mini pampering services are wonderful and are only $10 each. And I remember last time we did this, the next Sunday I was up here and women were like, oh my gosh, that was so great, so do go. I know that everybody had a great time. Hmm? You were radiant. It was an extra radiance that was just, it was hard to handle. So now I'd like to invite Jan Rudolph to the lectern.
Guess what? Yes, we are having a crab feed, and tickets go on sale today. For those of you who may be new to Unity or haven't attended our crab feed, it's a very popular and fun event. This year, the date is Saturday, February 22nd, so mark your calendars. In addition to crab, we will be serving salad, pasta, and garlic bread. Chicken and gluten-free options are also available. This is a fun event for everyone. Children of all ages are welcome. More details are available in your bulletin and online, and tickets can also be purchased online. Ticket sales and volunteer signups are on the patio today, and Leslie will be waiting for you.
Thank you, Jan. So please see our website and Unity's newsletter center point, which if you don't know what it looks like in print copy, is this version right here, for more information about these and other events on our calendar. You may pick up a newsletter in the bookstore or in your email box, which is a great way to get it because then you just get them all the time. And it's easy to sign up to receive the newsletter. Just fill out a connection card on the seat pocket in front of you. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Now, we've already had like four fabulous songs, but a couple of songs ago, which was the main opener, is a song that was written by Lisa and Tyler for the series we're launching today. So I just want to acknowledge that. It was beautiful. The one about the many rivers to the sea, you know. I hope you'll hear it again. Is that right? Is that the plan? Okay. Very good. It will be our theme song for our 10-week series we're starting today. Well, this is our time of meditation, and I'd like to begin our time with a reading as a part of our new interfaith series. And for those of you who are new to our process, it'll be followed by some music and then guided meditation and complete silence as a part of our time together in community with Spirit. So this is from Ibn Arabi, and it's called O Marvel. O Marvel, a garden amidst the flames, my heart has become capable of every form. It is a pasture for gazelles and a convent for Christian monks and a temple for idols and pilgrims Kaaba and the tables of the Torah and the book of the Quran. I follow the religion of love. Whatever way love's camel takes, that is my religion and my faith. Not only do we see that great I am in one another, in our very own reflection, and in all the life forms around us, we also feel that presence deep within us, in the heart of our hearts, in the soul. The one great soul. The I am is there in times of tragedy and peace, violence and harmony. There I am in the midst of you, where two or more are gathered. Peace is available to us always. The infinite love that connects all of us through our many paths and our many backgrounds, whether they be by faith or ethnicity, national boundary or tribe. There is that one true pulse of spirit that runs through all of us. It animates our beings, it opens our hearts. Guides us to take right action, make wise choices. And when we truly listen, those choices are always choices of connection and love, of wisdom and service. Even in the dark, here I am. So whatever you may be going through today, if it is a dark, seemingly dark time, know that darkness is not just a tomb, but a womb. Not just an ending, but a rebirth and a new beginning. Hold tight. Give over. Allow the darkness to take its place. Because even in that is the one great I am. So wherever we find ourselves today on our journey, we can take heart to know that spirit never leaves. The divine within is always here to guide and comfort, to open up a new way. And so it is with simply a breath, and a release of that breath, that we settle deep into our beings and rest in the divinity we all share, in the silence. At the points along our faith journey, the many paths converge. Those points along the way are stops like peace and love, harmony, understanding. And so it is toward those points of convergence that we cast our eyes and move our beings and rest our hearts and hope and faith. It is time. And so it is.
One power invisible, yet we see it everywhere and every day. One power indescribable, yet we speak of it with every word we say. Mysterious until you know the truth. As simple as the love inside of you. Call it God, call it Spirit, call it Jesus, call it Lord, call it Buddha, Baha'u'llah, Hashem, or Heaven's Door. But whatever name you give it, it's all one power. Clothing have different colors, different names, but different is only dangerous when we forget that in the heart we're all the same. We remember when we close our eyes to see that such distances were never meant to be. Call it Lord, call it Buddha, Baha'u'llah, Hashem, or Heaven's Door. It's Mohammed, it's your mind, it's your soul, or it's your sign. It's the universe, it's music, Mother Earth, or Father Time. But whatever name you give it, it's all one power, can't you see? It's the freedom of forgiveness. It's the sweetness of release. It's the joy of inspiration. It's the sunshine on your face. It's the birthright of all nations. It's the boundlessness. is forever in you and me. It's the power of love in you and me.
One power, one power, one I seem to remember a couple weeks ago Lisa saying, well, I'm not sure that I want to do the music or have me do the music again. I'm so glad you did. And this whole amazing team that comes together. Yes. That song, whew, isn't it a beauty? Daniel Namod, and you all did it proud today. It was featured at the Parliament of World Religions, and our local Interfaith Council CEO, or executive director, I guess you call him, Will McGarvey, had we were chatting one day, and he said, I don't know if you've ever heard this song, One Power. I heard it at the Parliament of World Religions, and we're wondering about getting this guy, Daniel Namod. Have you ever heard of him? I was like, yes, he's one of ours. So, yeah, beautiful. Beautiful to think about that, you know, that song was shared with the 10,000 people that show up at the Parliament of World Religions. If you ever, ever can have the opportunity to go there in person, go, or to tap in anyway in some way. I think they live stream a lot of that. The costumes of the world, the colors of the world, the spiritual practices of the world, all represented there in one gathering, gathering around world issues together as interfaith solution to the world's problems. You know, sometimes the religions cause some of the world problems, right? But most of all, we can be the resolution to that, and we can be a part of that. And that's really what our journey is all about that we're beginning today. The series is called Many Paths to the One. And it's nestled in this overarching season, the season for nonviolence. It all began, really, with Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi started a movement based on the Sanskrit word ahimsa. It sounds a bit like a greeting. You know, ahimsa. It's not a greeting. If it were, though, it would be a greeting of love and peace and respect for one another. It means literally nonviolence, and there's many derivations of what that's about. And Gandhi used that idea of ahimsa to win Indian independence from the British Empire, something nobody thought could be possible. And so the season for nonviolence was created by the Association of Global New Thought, of which Unity is affiliated, along with the grandson of Gandhi, Arun Gandhi. And together they came up with this idea that during this season from January 30th to April 4th that marks the assassination of Gandhi and the assassination of Martin Luther King would be a season of peace, a season for peace education, a season for peace commitment. So this year at Unity of Walnut Creek, we're really honoring and celebrating that season, and we're looking to it in many ways, and a big part of that is through the interfaith idea of the many paths to the one. So the Many Paths to the One is a Sunday series. It's also a class. So Thursday nights, you can join us for a 10-week class. Each, or most weeks anyway, if not every week, inside your bulletin, you will see a promo of what's coming this week. And if you haven't signed up for the whole class, but something piques your interest, I want to welcome you to come to that particular class. So this Thursday, it's going to be the Paganisms. And our own youth ministry director, Michelle Chakala, who's a part of that religious path as well, will be one of our presenters. So if you want to come on these weeks and you're not signed up for the regular class, please do sign up on the patio for this week's class so we know how many to plan for. One other aspect of Many Paths to the One is this beautiful artwork that is up on our wall. It's by David Brooks, one of our, I don't know if David's here. No, David's not here today. Asked David about the process by which he created this incredible work. Some of the symbols were symbols he knew, and some of them were things that just came through him, and he didn't even really know what they mean. He still doesn't know. So he was really in that divine creative flow when it was created. And it's on loan to us by Don and Danae, who are the owners of that beautiful piece. So thanks that you let us keep it for this long. And now that we're in the series, it's really nice to have art as well, because you know the power of art to really unite us as well, like the power of music and visual art and dance and all of the practices that might come with artistic expression really help ground us and teach us about one another's paths. You know, Lennon once said, if I keep listening to Beethoven's Appassionato, I won't finish the revolution. Because it is that power of art to bring forth peace and unison that that allows us to overcome. So as I'm looking out in the audience, I'm seeing some people I know who are artists for a living. So I know you know what I'm talking about, right? Yeah, Mario and Lena and others, Catherine. So, you know, in Unity, we really have not only a value that we hold for peace, but also in Unity across, and I mean Unity across the world, Unity Worldwide Ministries, Unity Headquarters, we hold this idea of peace. In fact, we have a peace statement that was written by Unity Worldwide Ministries and Unity Headquarters jointly about the time we went into the war with Iraq. And I'd like to share it with you today because you may not have heard it before, or you may have heard it and might like just grounding in this once again. It reads, Unity stands for peace in the presence of conflict, for love in the presence of hatred, for forgiveness in the presence of injury. Unity honors the many names for God, the many paths for God, the many ways to worship God. For there is only one power and one presence of God, and that God loves each one of us equally. It is therefore the position of Unity Headquarters and Unity Worldwide Ministries to urge all nations, their leaders, and their people to turn to God by whatever the name for guidance during these challenging times, and to pursue peace, not war. For this is what honors the God of all our faith traditions. Unity stands for peace in our lifetime. Nice to know that we're backed up by headquarters, isn't it? Tomorrow is Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday, and appropriately at this time, which is part of what sort of spurred us on to start our season for nonviolence a little bit early. And actually on Wednesday, we celebrate on Monday, but Wednesday would have been his birthday. This last Wednesday, he would have been 91 years old. I like to imagine him still amongst us. What would Martin Luther King Jr. be doing these days? A lot of the same work. A lot of the same work. You know, a lot of us know about Martin Luther King Jr. as somebody who rested his whole civil rights movement on the work that Gandhi started, on ahimsa, nonviolence, this idea of peace through nonviolence. And a lot of his work, of course, in the civil rights movement was mostly focused on racial equality, but of course that isn't, nothing can be compartmentalized completely, can it? He was also an interfaith visionary. Not everybody knows that. Abu Patel actually wrote an article. He's a Muslim American who wrote an article in the Huffington Post with that title. MLK was an interfaith visionary too. So you probably know about this pattern of nonviolence after Gandhi, but you might not know that 10 years after Gandhi made his transition, Martin Luther King traveled to India. And during that time, he was both surprised and inspired to see that people of all faiths were working together for peace. They were working together and drawing from that essence of love in their own faith traditions that King felt so deeply in Christianity. And it changed his life. It changed the direction of his life. He became much more interfaith after that experience. when he came back, and sometime after that, he became friends with Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel. And they walked arm in arm in the civil rights movement from Selma to Montgomery. Heschel said that our march was worship. I felt like my legs were praying. MLK also befriended Thich Nhat Hanh, the Buddhist monk. And it was Thich Nhat Hanh's friendship that influenced Martin Luther King to make a very controversial statement that he was against the Vietnam War. Had he not had the influence of his friendship with Thich Nhat Hanh, he might not have had that, well, he had lots of courage, but he might not have found it in himself to make that controversial statement at that time. He later wrote a letter nominating Thich Nhat Hanh for a Nobel Peace Prize, and in it he wrote that Thich Nhat Hanh was a holy man with ideas for peace that were really important to raise up for all of us. Sometimes it's in the most tragic situations of divisiveness that we find our love and our unison, isn't it? It's after difficult times that we realize what is now the pathway to peace, and we look around for solution. And we can, of course, be on a preventative path by making those bridges earlier. But when things happen, they happen, and we must also be with the darkness that, as was sung in the meditation, where the one is found, where the I am is with us, both in times of darkness and in light, found both in the darkness and in the light. I was thinking about some of the things that have happened in our lifetime, and unfortunately there's many things to point to that have been violent atrocities that have also had a really wonderful finish in peace and interfaith work. And one of those that came to mind was in 1995, you might remember the genocide that happened in Bosnia, what was once Yugoslavia. And during that time, 8,000 Bosnians were killed, mostly men and boys, and the women were very much a part, of course, of the atrocities, of the violence, of the war. But out of that tragedy, then, what comes? You know, what comes is a recognition that we need to understand one another, because much of that was ethnic and religiously motivated, right? That violence and that level of it's so hard to put our minds around. I think, you know, I find myself, and maybe you do too, we get so desensitized that it's just like we almost just kind of numb out when we hear about things like this or experience these things and to find out these kinds of things are going on in our world. And so it's like, what do we do? What do we do to unite? What do we do to be the peace that we want to have? What do we do to bring forth that essence of divine love? And we do things like coming together to understand one another. And that's just what's been happening there. It's not perfect, of course, by any means. But in 2010, there was a study where Bosnian Muslims were asked, you know, do you know something about Christianity? And if so, what do you think? Are there commonalities between Christianity and Muslims? And of course, those who reported that they knew something about Christianity said there was a lot of commonality. And those who didn't know much didn't think there was much commonality. Isn't that true for all of us? If we don't know our neighbors, if we don't know our brothers and sisters, if we don't know the many expressions of gender, ethnicity, religion, if we don't know what we might label the other, then we might tend to think that we are very different. And then we find out differently when we have a conversation or an opportunity to even have a sacred practice together. And so it's this journey of interfaith friends together, arm in arm, like Rabbi Heschel and Martin Luther King, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., that solidify that sense of partnership and togetherness and possibility that together we can unite for equality or justice or love or peace or all of it, really, because it all comes together, doesn't it? So back in Bosnia, in that terrible massacre was in 1995. That study I just mentioned was in 2010. And more recently, there was also an experience where they came together and in the Council of Mosques, and I think there's like five, yeah, these are five 21-year-olds, each of a different religion in that area, united together, coming together to create a whole new generation that understands one another, that finds the commonality on the many paths to the one, while still honoring the integrity and the diversity and the beauty of each path, but also finding the common ground together. And so it was at the Council of Mosques that gathered together this multi-faith event, and it included signing of the Srebrenica Solidarity Covenant, which is the place where this all took place. And this was signed by the young people, by the leaders, by the local council members and government officials, and by the community itself. This covenant for peace, this covenant to work together, this covenant to be arm in arm, side by side, to be part of a solution and a creation and a bringing forth of that one power, that one presence, that one love, that one peace that we all know through our own religious experiences, through our own spiritual paths, through our own backgrounds. And when it all is, you know, when we all sit in the same room and begin to talk about what it is that we really care about, as my friend Bruce Kellogg would say, what is the heart of your faith? That's his question to others. He always asks, what is the heart of your faith? It's a quite a different question than what are your beliefs or what is your doctrine or, you know, who do you pray to or who's your deity? No, what is the heart of your faith? That's the question we really want to know, right? What inspires you? What is, at the end of the day, what is it that you really feel like you believe? For what? For what reason? What is it that inspires you on this journey, this path? What is it that you envision? What is it that you're moving toward? What does it mean to be walking home? And so it's that question, I think, that we could take out into the community and to begin to ask one another and then listen. Inspired by St. Francis, we can say, my quest is to understand more so than to be understood, to listen and to ask and then listen. And it's our sharing too at some point, but not so much with the emphasis for us to be understood or for us to be right, certainly, but for us to find the places where we unite. And it's really much easier, I think, than we make it seem. You know, with all our misunderstandings, with all the ways that we operate as independent silos from one another. It's just knowing somebody. And then everything changes because we have a face on Islam, or we have a face on paganism, or we have a face on Hinduism or Buddhism or Jainism or Sikhism or whatever, Christianity, whatever it may be. That's really what we're about here. Understanding the way of peace is mapped by understanding. You know, and understanding isn't just an intellectual understanding. Certainly that's part of it. Comprehension is a part of the experience, but it's only just a little piece of the whole, you know. When we understand, it looks like empathy and sensitivity. When we understand, there's a reverence for what is sacred to someone else. Even if that particular thing is not so sacred to us. But there is a sense of understanding that reverence and holding space for that kind of reverence. That's how we build bridges. That's how we heal the world. That's how we transform. That's how we become who we've come here to be. It's simple, really, isn't it? You can do it every month. It's all created for us. The Interfaith Council of Contra Costa County does amazing things. I mean, every time I have the privilege to be a part of it, I meet a new friend of another faith or a new friend of another aspect of our faith and get to have conversations that are meaningful. You can be a part of the Interfaith Dialogues on the second Thursday of every month. At 8 o'clock, they gather for a little social time, and then at 8:30, they have the meeting, and they always have really interesting questions in interfaith circles that we discuss. What did I say? Oh, 8 a.m. Yeah, 8 o'clock a.m. Yes, thank you, Zula. Zula's on the Interfaith Council, by the way. Yeah, so thank you for being our representative on the council. Yeah, and it's at Hillcrest, which is just down the road in Pleasant Hill. So that's an opportunity. You don't have to go every month, but occasionally you can show up and meet a new friend. So there's so many opportunities, so many wonderful events out there that are just already ready-made for us. And here, particularly in the next 10 weeks, while we are focused on this idea. So understanding deepens us when we have a direct experience, like anything else, right? It's one thing to learn about something, a complete other thing to put your hands on it. You know, it's so different when somebody, you know, I don't know if you ever tried to learn something like behind the computer, and somebody who's really good at it, these digital natives, they just whisk right through it, you know? But it's not until you sit down behind it and they stand or sit behind you and they have to slow down so you can put your hands on it and experience it yourself, right? And it's kind of the same thing. It's very much like when Thomas said, you know, I'm not going to believe that Jesus is resurrected until I can reach out my hand and touch the wounds in his side. Because I want to touch the truth myself. I need to touch the truth myself. I need to have a firsthand experience, a sensory experience. And that's why ritual and practice is so important, because it engages our whole being. Our whole bodies get a cellular experience of what incense smells like and what the candle looked like as it was flickering and what the chant sounded like when it reverberated inside of us, not just as a passive listening experience. And so it is through practices, and when we are privileged enough to be invited in to practices of people of other faith traditions, we get to have that kind of experience. And so that is really what we're up to here. It is very much like when two or more are gathered, there I am in the midst of you. You know, when you are gathered together and you are dancing, you are singing, you are chanting, you are praying, you are meditating together, there is the experience of the divine. We touch it together. And nothing can shake those moments when we touch something like that together spiritually, when we experience the divine together at the same time, in the same heartbeat. That changes everything. And we carry those memories with us everywhere we go. And it informs our decisions and our choices to say no to divisiveness and yes to unification, to integration, to understanding, to peace, to love. In 2007, I went to India, a place I wanted to go for so long. And, you know, everybody was saying, oh, yeah, I'll go with you next year. And then that would fall away. And I'll go, you know. Finally, I was just like, I'm going. And luckily, my friend Jane said, you know, hey, would you like some company? That was months after. And I was like, oh, yes. So love a friend to go with me. And so together, one of the things that I read about that I really wanted to do was to hike to the source of the Ganges River. It's a sacred pilgrimage for Hindus to go to to hike all the way to the source of their four sacred rivers. And the Ganges is one of the biggest because it runs through so many of the cities. India is this beautiful paradox. It's got, you know, it's the birthplace of all these religions, and so there's this beautiful sort of devotional intermixing of so much going on. And at the same time, you know, this very sacred river, the Ganges, you can see, you know, the pollutants being dumped into it at the same time the prayers are being floated upon it, you know. So it's got this just constant paradoxical experience. But when you hike to the source, you get to that pure place of the river. You get to where the mother goddess Ganga originates, you know. And so it was a great privilege. And so these two young men became our guides very casually. It just all happened. And then a third young man joined them. And so he joined because he wasn't interested in a few extra rupees in his pocket. He joined because he was on a pilgrimage. And I didn't realize that until about halfway through the trip that he was really on a pilgrimage. He wasn't really there to support these two American tourists on their experience. So we got to the final temple, and it was just Jane and I and this young man whose name I can no longer remember. And we went to this little makeshift temple, where another young man greeted us and guided us through some prayers and preparation for coming to the other side and to this place where there was a blue ice glacier. And my friend Jane said she saw this image of the goddess Ganga straddling that river. But the greatest experience wasn't just the cold water on my face where ice chunks were floating. Talk about a polar ice plunge, right? But was when this man, who was on his pilgrimage of a lifetime, that Hindus dream about and not all can do, that he immersed himself. It was like the lost son coming home to his goddess mother. I mean, it was one of the most beautiful experiences. And just to stand witness to that, you know, just to be able, it isn't something I could fully touch myself, but I could feel it. I could hold space for it. I could observe the depth of what that was. And those moments that we get in our lifetime, we don't get unless we take ourselves out of our routines and our safe places and go somewhere else, whether it's down the street to the Interfaith Council or to walk into a local synagogue or a mosque and experience something new. Or maybe for many of us, the place that might push our buttons the most is the other end of Christianity, you know, the evangelical end of Christianity, you know, just to go ahead and experience that. I remember going to a Pentecostal church service once, and I left. I could hardly drive. It was like I was drunk. Not that I would know what that felt like, but but I was spiritually drunk, you know? And so it was just, I literally sat in my car and said, I don't know if I'm fit to drive, because the charisma of that experience, the charisma of the prayers and the music. Now, the message, I completely tuned out because I didn't agree, you know, I just couldn't find resonance with it. But it was the experience of the prayer and the music that lifted up my energy. And so having those experiences allows me to find a place to plug in, to find a place of commonality. So if I do have a conversation with someone Pentecostal, I don't want to talk about our doctrines. I don't want to hear about your message and have you hear mine and we'll try to figure out where we're right and where we're wrong. I want to ask you, what is the heart of your faith? Because I had experience in one of your churches that was really profound. What is it about that that allowed me to feel like I was levitating? What happened there? Does that happen for you? That's the conversation I want to have. It's a totally different conversation. It has a quality to it that allows us to be rooted in the divinity that we all share and the infinite love that paves every path to the One. That's what we're about, is understanding, coming to this kind of understanding together. Our inner spiritual approaches to world problems come to this well of a value base that we all share, because at the root of all these paths is these values of things like harmony and equality and justice and compassion and love and peace, and all of that matters to all of us. And so when we can get on that page, then we can enjoy the diversity of expressions with those holistic intents that we all share. It becomes then, in a way, our collective world mission as interfaith friends. We need each other. We need spiritual citizenry, you know, to awaken, to enliven us, to allow us to heal what ails our world, to heal the places where we are otherizing one another. And you may say, all of that is good and all of that is great, except for, and wherever your except for is, move toward that. Because that's where the healing begins. That's where the opening can happen. That's where the salve can be poured upon the wound. And you too can heal that space of divisiveness or otherness or woundedness. And then, guess what? We become the wounded healers of the world. It isn't until we push ourselves a little bit to those edges that we will really become and step into the kind of brave spiritual citizens that we've really come here to be, to really, truly transform and awaken our world. We can become like little children again, you know, curious and open and alive, like the little toddler whose sign I saw at the Women's March yesterday that said, "I'm woke and I haven't even had a nap." So let's expand our understanding together. Let's make a way for peace by doing that. And let's do it by linking arms with our interfaith friends. Let's affirm it together. I expand my understanding and make way for peace with friends of all faiths. So it is.
Kristen, thank you. And thank you for launching all of us on this journey together for the next 10 weeks. I know I'm excited, and I think everybody else here is too. It's going to be fun together. Our prayer chaplains are available after the service to provide personal prayer support. If you are a prayer chaplain serving today, please stand. As you'll see, many of you guys are here today. Our prayer chaplains have their beautiful lavender stoles on, except for one of us. And whether you have a joy or concern in your heart today, praying with our prayer chaplains is a powerful opportunity to have your intentions raised up in consciousness. And now let's open our hearts to the practice of giving. I invite you to prepare your gifts as we align with the universal law of circulation. As we give, we shall receive, because in truth there is no lack or limitation, and abundance is our true nature. For your convenience, there are a variety of ways to financially give to this community. For electronic giving, you may download the Give app or take an envelope from the clipboard in front of you. Those of you at home may click the Give Here or Donate button on the Watch Live page. And now I invite you to take your tithe or offering in your hand and repeat our affirmation together. Divine love, one with me, blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, all that I receive. I am joy-filled and grateful. Thanks.
You're going to help me sing this song? I need you to sing the word one. Sing that with me. One. You can sing it up high. One, you can sing it out loud. One, we are all one. Only one power, there's one. One, it all comes down to one. Thank you. Be ready. Billions live their lives that Muhammad, Krishna, or the Buddha are the believe it's right to say in the name of Jesus when they pray. We are a human kind of 7 billion, so many different races and religions, and it all comes down to one. God's a him. Still many believe that he is a her. Does God live in our hearts? Or is she somewhere out there in the universe? We are a human kind of 7 billion. So many days. and it all comes down to one. How far will we have to go before we learn the lesson? Gandhi was a Hindu, Martin Luther King a Christian. Regardless of religion, they knew love was the mission. And it all comes down to one. Is there no God at all? Or a pantheon of gods up in the sky? We can heal our broken. Prosperity and peace. If tolerance is the seed, then the gift of pure acceptance is the tree. Or white, man with a husband or a woman with a wife, debate until the end of time who's wrong and who is right, or we can see ourselves as one, because it all comes down to love. We are a human kind. Seven billion, so many different races and religions, and it all comes down to one.
Yet another wow. Thank you. Thank you. Come on up. So held here is baskets filled with symbols. Symbols of our prosperity, our abundance, our belief in the work that we do together. And so we thank you, God, for this overflowing abundance that serves us, that supports us, that allows us to walk together on that one or that many pathed place to the one. Let's bless this good together. We give thanks for the ever-increasing, constant flow of absolute good in our lives now. Look at all the children coming in. All right.
Good morning, everybody. I was filling in for Michelle today. I'm Ashley, and we had a wonderful time. We talked about Ruru, And we told a Buddhist tale. We're continuing with the interfaith curriculum that Michelle was able to purchase with the pumpkin money, and which I love. I love that that was the seed that she planted with that fruit. And we talked about peace today. And the story, can you guys tell what the story was about? I'm doing all the talking here. Anybody want to share? Yeah. Yeah. What kind of animal was the story about today? Anybody want to? Yeah.
Deer.
Deer.
And what was special about the deer? Can you tell? These two are being shy today without mom here. Okay, so the deer, he was a wise and beautiful deer in the forest, and he helped a man, the man in turn didn't treat him kindly, and then his response to that unkindness was to still be kind and still wish for peace for the man and know that the man had made a bad decision but was not a bad person. To kind of separate those two things out. So we had a conversation about that. So, yeah. You guys want to add anything else today? No, we're being very quiet today. Okay.
Was the deer someone special?
Oh, yes. Out? Who was the deer supposed to represent in the story? Yes. You want to share? Who was the deer supposed to? Oh. You want to be shot? Okay. Do you remember who the deer was supposed to represent, Adeline?
Buddhist.
The Buddha. That's right. The Buddha.
Yes. Nice. Okay. Beautiful. Well, thank you, Ashley and Gia and Stephanie for leading our children today. And let's bless our children and teachers. Children, youth, and teachers, we love you. We appreciate you. And we behold the divine light within you. I invite you now, if you'd like to take your neighbor's hand, if you're comfortable doing that, as we close out with our prayer of protection and our peace song.
Can I hold your hand?
Together? The light of God surrounds us. I am light. The love of God enfolds us. I am love. The power of God protects us. I am power. The presence of God watches over us. I am presence. Wherever we are, God is. I am divine. Are the light and the love and the peace on earth right now. So let your light shine, have fun, and spread joy.